非常欢迎大家加入我们今天的讲座。那么我和我的同事呢，今天会和大家一起来探讨关于跨境资产保护的问题，跨境资产保护和规划。那么我呢会来进行这个前半段的讲解，主要会跟大家讲解为何要考虑资产规划、保护财产、遗嘱认证、配偶的财产权以及信托这些课题。那么我的同事 Jay Rifkin 呢会给大家讲解税务规划、移民前资产和税务规划、房地产投资以及一些实践操作的案例，包括最后呢给大家做一个总结，怎样的针对您的这个个人的情况和资产的金额，怎样是比较适当的资产规划，以及接下来的行动计划。那我们首先呢可以来一个简单的灵魂拷问。假如您的一生从出生到死亡是一根横轴线的话，您可以考虑一下自己目前为止走到哪里了呢？那我们为什么要来考虑这个财产规划的问题呢？简单来说，在美国，财产规划是有四大作用。第一是保护财产，包括保护您本身的财产，甚至是您孩子和孙辈、曾孙辈的财产，整个来说就是家族的财产。第二呢，是可以保护你，避免遗嘱认证的这个过程。遗嘱认证呢，是一个比较相对复杂的这个美国继承的一个法庭程序，我待会儿呢会进行一个讲解。第三呢，是为了保护隐私，因为遗嘱认证的过程呢是没有隐私可言的，所有您所有的资产、所有的家庭事务都会公开在世人的面前，所以保护隐私是一个比较重要的问题。当然呢，最后一点，税务规划。这个就是，如果就是说遗产还财产规划的准确和不准确，是不是到位的话，可能会引起几千万甚至是几亿美金，取决于您财产的这个数额哈，可能会带来重大的这个出入。最后一点来说呢，从我们多年实践的结果来看，对大多数客户来说，当他们完成自己的财产规划的那一天呢，他们都会非常的开心。都会如释重负，觉得他们的生命的满意度，提高了很多，可以说是有一个 peace of mind。那我先来讲一下这个财产保护的问题。怎样的人是需要来考虑他的财产保护问题呢？第一类是说，如果您的家庭婚姻和子女的状况比较复杂，比如说是有多次婚姻，然后各自从不同的婚姻中带来不同的子女。等等，就婚姻、家庭、子女状况比较复杂，这是第一类人士。第二类呢，是企业主或者是比较成功的专业人士。那么大家通常知道的这个破产，但是因为财产这个及时的规划，并且进行有效的规划，能够不受破产这个影响的企业家的话呢，在中国来说，贾跃亭是一个非常有名气的一个案例。那么，在美国来说呢，其实不仅是企业主，很多成功的专业人士，比如说医生、律师这些具有专业责任的人士呢，他也都是要比较注重他的财产保护。第三类人士呢，是财产额度比较大，这个当然是非常容易理解，对吧？财产额度比较大的话，那么各方面的冤亲债主，我们说都会追上门来。比如说，你企业在那个上市之前呢，或者是公司做大了要卖的时候啊。就各种各样的人，他会冒出来，我们叫这个债权人或者是财产掠夺者。所以财产额度比较大的人士呢，是要非常注重财产保护的。还有第四类人士呢，是喜欢冒险的人士，不管是在商业上还是在个人生活中，比如说喜欢这个极限的体育运动啊，在生活爱情方面比较喜欢冒险的人士啊，那么他们是要注重财产保护的。那么，财产保护非常重要的一个武器就是不可撤销的信托。信托我待会会仔细讲。简单的来说，不可撤销的信托就是说，可以把财产的所有权从您个人或者是家庭转移到这个信托名下，因为它是不可撤销的，所以你在放弃这个名义上对财产控制权的同时呢，也就把财产的 ownership，我们说 title，就是财产的所有权转移出去了。那么这样的时候，您的本人的债权人、第三方，甚至是政府，都不可以对这个信托、不可撤销的信托进行追责。 那么最近呢，因为这个俄罗斯和乌克兰的冲突哈，很多的客户就来问我们说，哎，你看新闻里面说，今天、明天哪一位的这个俄罗斯的石油寡头，他的财产，比如说他的船、飞机，或者说他的这个房产又被没收了。那如果当地缘政治产生重大的冲突，或者是受到这个外国，包括是西方很多国家制裁的情况下，那么怎么样来保护个人的财产呢？那么首先我要明确一个问题哈，就大家新闻里面听到的这些所谓的俄罗斯石油寡头财产的没收，这个不是说你只要是俄罗斯的公民，你在美国或英国这些西方国家的财产都会被没收，这个绝对不是这样的。实际上，绝大多数可以说99.9%以上的俄罗斯的公民，还有他在海外的资产，都是个人私有财产受到保护的。所谓这个石油寡头，是指少数的在美国制裁清单上明确上名单的就那几个人，或者是说几十个人。这个寡头是非常非常小的，而且他之所以个人的名字上清单的话，是因为他和比如说俄罗斯总统普京有着千丝万缕的联系，然后他个人在财富积累的过程中呢，也是动用了一些国家力量，这样的人呢才会上我们所说的这个清单，就是术语来说就是 SDN list，就是一个美国制裁的清单。这一般来说呢，个人其实不存在这个问题，但是即使存在这个问题呢，不可撤销的信托以及其他的一些适当的财产保护问题呢，同样可以抵御这个第三方甚至是政府的这个掠夺和没收。那么，好多华人，包括是比如说中国身份，然后后来到美国来的这些人士呢，他都会来问我们，就说我在财产出来了以后，在哪个国家放在哪个国家最安全？那么哪个国家最安全的话呢？我们是进行一个非常专门的比较，比较的这个。我们有一个表格，非常详细的表格。那比较的对象呢，主要就是说一个国家它对资产是不是有保护性比较强，财产放在这个国家比较安全，主要是要看这个国家的银行保密性是否和不同国家的政府提供双边司法协助，是否存在资产保护信托立法，国家本身政治和军事上的稳定性，有无信托这个受托的期限。信托财产的限制，力托人是否有权保留各种权利，包括罢免受托人，以及受益人是否有知情权？就一个国家，它这个资产保护的力度，主要就是看这些方面，它我们叫 score，它的得分是多少？那么根据这个得分的统计结果是说，我刚才说这表格非常复杂，演算的过程非常复杂。但是结果是，美国是世界上资产保护力度最强的国家之一。当然，也有一些其他的国家，但是美国是资产保护最强的国家之一。但是很多这些其他的国家呢，因为它本身没有一个让你可以生活的环境，比如说它就是一个小岛，甚至是一个荒岛。那么资产真的放在那边以后呢，就纯粹是一个属地的资产，就是等于是一个空壳放在那里。但是比如说子女要教育啊。然后要买房产啊等等的话呢，还是会存在不方便的地方。那么在所有就是说人真是可以生活，而且下一代可以世世代代的去受教育，然后就成家立业的这些国家相比之下呢，美国可以说是资产保护力度最强的国家之一。那我刚才说了这个财产规划的第二个主要的目的是规避美国的遗嘱认证。什么是遗嘱认证呢？这个英语里面就是我们平时经常听到的这个词儿叫 probate。简单来说，probate 遗嘱认证是指各个州的法院对一个人的遗嘱的有效性和真实性的一个确认过程。有一点大家要记住，很重要的是说，在美国，当一个人除非他是有信托，没有信托的话，遗嘱认证是遗产继承的唯一途径，就不管是在哪一个州。啊，您要继承别人的遗产，或者您的遗产要被别人继承，唯一的途径就是遗嘱认证。那么，遗嘱认证我刚才说了，是一个复杂的法庭程序，要完成这个法庭程序的时间和费用呢，在每个州是不一样。 通常是9到24个月，但是在新冠期间呢，甚至是延长到3年。那比如说我们家邻居，他们就是父亲过世以后，他的房产想要由他的子女来继承，但是因为这个遗嘱认证花了3年的时间，这3年这个房产都没有办法发生转让，也子女也不能去卖这个房产。那么这3年中呢，每一个月的这个我们叫 carry cost， 他的房产税和他的那个房子维护的费用都要上万块钱，因为房子很大。那么就要连续交3年这个费用，而且呢当他可以卖房子的那个时候呢，市场也许并不好，所以你就等于可能会错过这个时机。如果是有价证券的话，那么这个错过3年的话，那可能就错过了好几个市场周期，所以呢这个等待的时间就会有产生很多时间上的损失以及相应的经济损失。同时呢，法院进行遗产认证它是要收费的，总体费用是占总体资产总额的4%到8%，这是相当高的一个比例。另外我刚才一开始的时候就说了，因为是一个法庭程序，所有的案卷都是公开，所以您的个人财产和家庭情况是没有任何隐私可言的。另外呢，也容易发生争议，遗嘱认证过程中很容易发生争议。比如说老年人他年纪大了以后，现在平均寿命越来越长，活到80多岁90多岁，这是很正常的。那么他如果是年纪大了以后有帕金森症，或者是他的行为意志容易被人控制的话，那么他的遗嘱的真实性或者是有效性就有可能受到不同的子女甚至是不同的亲戚的挑战。所以这遗嘱认证不仅是费时费力，而且它会失去隐私，并且引发亲人之间的争议。另外呢，中美当中有很多跨境的因素，增加了这个遗产继承的复杂性。比如说如果您个人是美国公民或者是居民，那么美国的遗产税和赠与税是对您在全球范围内的资产，包括您在中国、香港任何地方的资产，如果您是美国公民或居民的话，您在全球范围内的资产都要受美国遗产税和赠与税的管辖，这个税率是40%，也就是您所有税收的这个所有财产的40%。当然前面的600万是免税的，就是600多万是免税的，所以你是美国公民和居民的话呢，又可以享受，每个人目前是可以享受600万出头的一个免税额，这个待会我们具体会说哈。如果是非美国公民和居民，那您就只需要就位于在美国境内的资产交遗产税或者是赠与税，也是40%。那比如说现在有很多非美国人，就是华人，他在美国买这个房产或者是其他的投资，那么他即使他本人不是美国公民和居民，但是在美国境内的资产他是要交遗产税和赠与税，而且我刚才说的这600多万的免税额对他们是不适用的，因为外国人他只有6万块钱的免税额，所以是外国人他就说海外的资产不用在美国交遗产税或者是赠与税，只需要就美国的资产交，但是他没有那么高的一个免税金额。所以呢，就是中美之间他这些跨境因素呢也会导致这个遗产继承的复杂性。另外从这个法律和文化上面，中美在继承方面的区别是很大的。比如说在中国，一个人过世的时候，他如果没有遗嘱的话，法定的继承的话是第一就是我们说的直系亲属，父母、配偶和子女，他是有同位继承权。也就是说如果您有一个父母里面有一个健在，然后您的配偶还在，然后有一个孩子，那么这三人是一人三分之一。这是中国的话，你没有遗嘱的话，这是中国法律的这个既定的一个状况。在美国的话是很不一样的，在美国财产大家记住是从上往下继承的，不会倒过来，基本上不会倒过来。所以就是第一继承人就是配偶和孩子，所以一个人过世的时候如果没有做出特殊的安排，遗嘱或者信托的话，那么根据法定的继承，父母是一分钱也拿不到的。所以就是前一阵时间大家可能很关注的加州的这个问题，就是加州的一位谷歌的工程师，他太太去世以后，他很快就是又结婚了，组成了新的家庭， 并且和新的太太一起把之前的岳父母赶出了他们共同居住了很多年的房子。那么在美国，大家要记住，除非你给父母做出特殊安排的话，根据法律的话，第一继承人是配偶和孩子，只要他们当中的任何一个人在，那父母是一分钱也分不到。如果配偶和孩子都不在，那么就是孙辈，就是你的 grandchildren， 孙辈里面只要有一个人在，你的父母还是分不到。所以我就说了，美国是从上到下看未来的一个继承的方式。只有当你配偶、子女、孙辈完全都没有的话，法律才会让你的父母来继承这个财产。当然如果父母也没有的话，那么就是兄弟姐妹。这种情况虽然发生的几率比较小，但是现实生活中的确是有发生的情况。所以大家就是说，如果想孝顺父母，对父母有一些保障的话，不管他是在中国还是在美国啊，都要有一个安排。要不没有一个特殊的安排的话，父母是基本上得不到任何保障的。那所以加州的这个事情出来以后，我们有很多朋友就来问我说，那我能不能生前赠与，对吧？我人还在的时候，我就对给父母进行一个生前赠与。那生前赠与其实是一个打补丁的方法，它会引发出很多其他的问题，今天就没有时间多说。总的来说就是说，第一是你肯定就生前就丧失了这个对财产的控制权，而且呢，生前赠与最大的一个坏处是会丧失递增的一个税基。这个问题有点复杂，但总的来说也就是说，你遗产继承的时候，税基是你继承时候的市场公允的价格的税基，但是如果是生前赠与的话，那你就是比如说房产收购时候的这个价格是作为税基，所以您可能生前赠与的话会导致损失一大笔这个税基，损失税基也就是损失就会要多交很多税的这个问题。所以这是一个关于遗嘱认证。所以遗嘱认证很复杂，一般来说我们都是建议大家避免遗嘱认证，因为损失很多的时间经济，并且导致很多的问题。那么另外在讲这个财产的时候呢，我觉得有一点很关键的需要跟大家解释一下，就是配偶的财产问题，配偶的财产权。那么任何继承和赠与，大家要记住这个关键点是说，您只能给出您拥有的东西，如果你不拥有一样东西的话，你是不能给出的。比如说一个例子就是共同财产，不管是说我们因为法律上或者是合同上形成的共同财产，比如说您开账户的时候和兄弟姐妹一起开一个账户，叫那个 joint tenancy， 这种就是共同账户，或者是说因为婚姻原因导致的这个夫妻共同财产，我们叫这个 community property with right of survivorship。 还有其他的一些财产已经不受你这个支配和管辖的，比如说你的这个人身保险，人身保险的受益人你已经指定了，叫 life insurance with beneficiary designation， 人身财产这个保险已经受益的指定了。另外还有就是退休金账户，如果已经指定受益人的这些退休金账户，那么你就不能够再去支配它或者是给出这些财产，因为这些财产就已经是各自有人认领了，等于不管是因为共同财产还是说你当时就已经是指定受益人的财产，除非你改变这个受益人，但你不能说啊，你的人身保险当时设人身保险的时候指定是这个受益人，但是遗嘱里面又说另外一个人是受益人，这样的话那个遗嘱就是那一部分就是无效的。所以那么你能给出的资产，不管是赠与还是遗产，只能是你个人拥有的东西。那么怎么样的东西是您个人拥有的财产呢？比如说你已婚的话，那么你婚前的财产还有婚后接受的遗产和赠与，如果没有和配偶财产混淆在混杂在一起的话，那些是您的个人财产。而婚后购买的资产就是属于夫妻共同财产，不管是婚后购买的房产还是婚后产生的各种收入，这些呢都是属于夫妻共同资产。不管你的房契地契上是 title 是谁，贷款是可能是你一个人的，但是如果是结婚的话，那么是夫妻共同财产。还有很多州在美国，比如说加州啊、德克萨斯州、华盛顿州、 Arizona 亚利桑那州，有些州的话夫妻财产就是认定为是夫妻共有财产。所以这些夫妻共有财产的话呢，你也不可能单个的去转给你的父母， 这是夫妻双方要共同同意的情况下才能发生这个赠与或者是继承。那最后我来简单的讲一下这个信托的问题。刚才讲了，不管是因为这个美国和中国这个法律文化的差异，还有大家可能就是说刚刚了解到的遗产认证过程中产生的很多麻烦，以及夫妻可能结婚之前没有那个婚前财产公证，也没有做这个婚前的这个叫 prenup， 就是婚前财产分割的协议的话，那么很多问题怎么解决呢？常用的一个办法就是信托。信托这个词儿可能大家听到的情况是越来越多了。什么是信托呢？信托其实是一个合同，就是由立托人、受托人和受益人三方产生的一个合同。信托的一个主要的作用就是遗产管理、婚姻财产保护、隔离你个人的财产、信托财产和个人财产分开、避税，并且保护您的隐私。信托主要可以分为两大类，可撤销信托和不可撤销信托。那么从保护个人财产的角度来说呢，只有不可撤销的信托才有那个功能。可撤销，所谓可撤销信托就是说你生前你还活着的时候就可以撤销的这个信托。那既然是您拥有这么大的控制权可以撤销它，那么就不具有说和你财产分割的这个作用。然后刚才说的这个立约的三方就是受托人、受益人和这个立托人。那么立托人就是比如说你创建和控制这个信托的这个人是立托人。受托人呢就是受您管理，受托人就受您的这个委托，对这个信托进行管理的这一位人士，我们叫 trustee， 受托人。受益人就是 beneficiary， 就是接受这个财产的最开心的这个人，受益人。那么怎么样的人呢是比较适用于机构信托人，怎么样的人呢适用于这个个人受托人呢？就说一般来说受托人在日常生活中常见两种，一种是个人的受托人，一种是机构的受托人。个人我们叫 individual trustee， 对吧？个人的话财产比较小，那您可以找到一个美国的个人，而且他各方面的信任度啊、胜任度啊，他对这个财产管理的能力都比较强的情况下呢，可以用这个个人受托人。但是如果财产比较大，比如说高于100万美金以上，1000万美金以上，并且这个财产的情况比较复杂，管理起来比较复杂的话呢，可能就需要一些机构的信托人来参与这个专业的管理。那所以呢，今天花了一点时间就给大家讲解了一下这个财产保护当中最基本的一些概念的。接下来呢，我会请我的这个同事 Jay Rifkin 先生呢，来给大家讲解这个税务规划，就是资产规划里面的税务规划问题。那么很抱歉的是 Jay 他不会说中文，还在学习的过程中，所以呢我们今天是把他的这一部分的 PPT 呢翻译成比较详细的翻译成中文，他会用英文来讲解，但是大家我相信大多数的英文还是很好的，同时呢通过这个对 PPT 书面的这个 PPT 的阅读呢希望能够大家还是能够听懂，如果有什么问题的话也没关系，我们这个讲完以后也不会给大家考试的，所以听不懂没关系，我觉得能听懂他讲的这一部分，您如果能听懂20%-30%其实就算不错了，那有问题的话我们可以事后再交流好吗？
Thank you, Catherine. So we're going to get into some case studies as we move along in the materials, but it's always important to kind of level set and explain what the primary goals of estate planning are, and also talk about what the general rules are. So,you know, one of the primary objectives with estate planning is to try to minimize U.S. estate tax. And for a U.S. citizen or somebody who is what's called a domiciliary in the U.S., so somebody who's resident in the U.S. and is not intending to leave, is entitled to an exemption from U.S. estate tax of $12,060,000 per individual. So for a married couple, it's over $24 million between the married couple that ultimately can be passed to the next generation, children and grandchildren, free of U.S. federal estate tax. One cautionary note, there are a number of states that have their own standalone estate tax. So for example, the state of New York has an estate tax that applies at a much lower threshold. The exemption is just approximately $6.1 million per individual.For non-U.S. persons, so people that are not domiciled in the U.S., the exemptions are much different. It's actually only a $60,000 exemption per individual. So, you know, with the tax rate being 40% on assets over that $60,000 exemption. The major difference aside from the exemptions between a U.S. person and a non-U.S. person is that for U.S. persons, once you exceed that $24 million of total exemption, you're taxed on a worldwide basis. So assets that are located in the U.S. and assets that are located abroad. For a non-U.S. person, the only assets that are going to be subjected to a U.S. estate tax would be assets that are located physically here in the U.S.
Thank you, Jay. This is such an important number. So you mentioned as a couple, you got a $24 million exemption. As an individual, $6 million exemption, right? A $12 million. Then what does the $6 million apply to?
So the $6 million exemption is for New York State purposes. Yes. So anything over $6 million would be subjected to New York State estate tax, which is a separate tax with a top tax rate of 16%.
Yeah. Yep. That's on top of the 40%.
Correct. It's on top of the federal tax. So the net effective rate for both New York and federal is pushing almost 50%. And the reason for that is the New York tax is going to be deductible on the federal estate tax return. One other note about the U.S. exemptions, again, these are for U.S. persons. They're scheduled to sunset at the end of 2025, and that $12 million exemption per individual is going to fall back to $6 million per person approximately, so $12 million per couple. There are a number of exceptions to what is ultimately subjected to tax, and I'll just roll through those very quickly. For U.S. persons, again, you can leave up to $12 million free of estate tax during your lifetime by making lifetime gifts. There's also something called the annual exclusion. So every person can give $16,000 to any number of individuals that they want each year, and that's not going to be subjected to U.S. gift or estate tax. And ultimately, you know, for a married couple, it's actually $32,000 per individual. For non-U.S. persons, again, there is no lifetime exemption. That exemption is only $60,000 for estate tax purposes, and there's zero exemption for gift tax purposes. A couple of caveats. The first is that, again, that annual exclusion does apply, so $16,000 per person per year. And in addition, if you've got children or grandchildren that are attending school or need, you know, medical here in the U.S., if you make those payments directly to the educational institution or directly to the doctor or hospital provider, those gifts as well are not subjected to the exemptions. So with those rules in mind, I want to be thinking about a little bit what does it mean for somebody to engage in pre-immigration planning. Next slide, please. So with pre-immigration planning, you know, that can encompass both pre-immigration planning for income tax purposes as well as for U.S. estate and gift tax purposes. And it can apply to somebody who, again, is not a U.S. person currently, but is intending to, for example, pick up a green card in the U.S. Or ultimately move to the U.S. for an indeterminate period of time. Alternatively, it could also include, you know, if you've got children or grandchildren that ultimately intend to settle in the U.S., you know, that also can necessitate some pre-immigration planning. So what can be done? So in an example where somebody is going to move to the U.S. and establish residency in the U.S., for income tax purposes, you really need 5 years to properly plan. And the reason for that is if you make transfers within a five-year window and then move to the U.S., you know, ultimately the U.S. is going to sweep those transfers back in. One potential arbitrage, though, is to actually irrevocably sell assets. So if you sell assets before you establish residency in the U.S., you recognize the capital gains tax, the income tax that might be due on those assets in a foreign jurisdiction. Then what you're doing is resetting the basis. It's going to be a basis of fair market value for U.S. purposes. You've sold the assets and you can reinvest the cash however you deem advisable. The benefit there is only to the extent that the tax that's paid in the foreign jurisdiction before you establish residency is less than what the U.S. capital gains tax would be, which is 23.8%. So that's really it for income tax purposes. For estate and gift tax purposes, there's a lot more that can be done from a pre-immigration planning perspective. So one idea is to irrevocably gift assets that are situated abroad to, you know, foreign family members or friends. The other thing that can be done is you can establish a U.S. trust. So for example, if grandma and grandpa are having their U.S. grandchildren or their existing grandchildren attend school in the U.S., one idea would be to set up a U.S. trust for the benefit of those grandchildren and to make gifts of non-U.S. status assets, so assets that are located outside the U.S., and ultimately those assets then could go into the trust and be protected for the benefit of the grandchildren. Next slide, please. So that dovetails nicely with our case study on pre-immigration planning. So in this example, we had somebody who was a non-U.S. person, a Chinese citizen, who had just arrived in the U.S. and hadn't picked up a green card yet, had not become what's called domiciled for estate and gift tax purposes. And he had a very significant realization of event abroad and sold a listed company for $550 million. And he had a substantial amount of cash and security situated offshore. What he told us is that he intended for his children to also move with him and that he expected that the children would ultimately pick up green cards, potentially citizenship, and likely to be in the U.S. on a long-term basis. So what we recommended is what's called a pre-immigration estate planning trust. It's an irrevocable structure, which means that it cannot be revoked. And what the client did was effectively settle the trust by transferring assets of approximately $25 million into the trust. The trust was a U.S. trust because we had individuals, ultimately the client's children, who were going to be U.S. persons. And the savings right off the top was effectively 40% of that $25 million transfer. So right out of the gate, we saved approximately $10 million of U.S. estate tax. And the reason for that is that once those assets are in trust, provided that that there's proper planning, those assets will be not only exempt from estate tax in the event that the client were to die, but also exempt from the estate tax at each death of the beneficiary. So the assets can pass plus the appreciation from generation to generation. Next slide. So what Catherine and I find primarily with international clients is one of the first assets that, you know, non-U.S. persons want to buy in the U.S. is real estate. And real estate really requires proper planning if you're looking to exclude it from your estate. So again, if you're a non-U.S. person and you're making investments in the U.S., if you're going to invest in real estate, you buy that real estate directly and you own it directly, then ultimately at your passing, you're going to have that $60,000 exemption, and anything in excess of the $60,000 is going to be subjected to U.S. estate tax. So there are a number of ways in which we properly plan. The first would be to set up a structure in which we establish a foreign corporation, which means a corporation that's situs and located outside of the U.S., and we have the foreign corporation purchase the real estate. So in effect, the client is funding the foreign corporation with assets offshore, and the foreign corporation is then turning around and buying the U.S. real estate. That's a really powerful planning technique because the shares in the foreign corporation are not deemed to be U.S. situs, which means that when somebody passes away, those foreign shares, even though the corporation owns the real estate, are ultimately excluded from the individual's estate. Using a foreign corporation can be coupled with also using a U.S. LLC. And the primary reason to use the U.S. LLC and have that owned by the foreign corporation is to avoid FERPTA. So when a non-U.S. person sells real estate, either that's owned directly or through a U.S. structure, ultimately what happens is there is a 15% deemed tax, which is the FERPTA tax or FERPTA withholding that's imposed. And it's a 15% tax on the amount realized. So if you purchase a piece of property for $1 million and you sell it for $3 million, the 15% applies to the $3 million total amount realized. There's a way around FERPTA, and the best way to do that is, again, to structure ownership through a U.S. limited partnership or a U.S. LLC, and then have that U.S. Limited partnership or U.S. LLC owned by a foreign corporation. The other approach, again, is to have the use of a trust. And here, this could be either a foreign trust or a U.S. trust. Again, U.S. trusts are generally better for individuals who are going to have U.S. beneficiaries in their family chain. and a foreign trust may be appropriate for non-US persons. Next slide, please. So this is a case study in terms of how to structure real estate acquisition. And in this instance, the client was actually a non-US person residing in Canada. And in this instance, what we decided to do is set up a foreign trust, a Canadian trust. The client settled the trust with the amount of the purchase price. And then ultimately the trust purchased the asset, which was a property in Los Angeles, California. There is often an argument that when the grantor funds a foreign trust and then the foreign trust turns around and buys property in the US, that if the grantor is going to use the home, going to enjoy the home on a periodic basis, there's an argument that that trust is self-settled and the structure is busted, which means that the US will look through the structure and still treat the grantor as owning the property. So in this particular instance, what we did as a planning technique was to have the trust buy 90% of the property and have the client take title to the other 10%. And by doing that, the 10% is included in the client's estate for US estate tax purposes, but will ultimately get to take discounts for lack of marketability and lack of control when the client passes away. And we're able to shelter a substantial amount from US estate tax exposure to the extent that the client dies owning that 10% interest.
Just a small correction on the Chinese slide, we're missing some words here. The client is a Chinese citizen and a Canadian resident.
Thank you. Next slide, please. So the other example is restructuring. And restructuring can be very difficult, but it comes up a lot in both of our practices, because what ends up happening again is a client buys real estate, they take title directly, maybe they worked with a real estate broker, but they didn't have a lawyer to help them with the structuring. So now they've taken title to the property directly. What are some of the techniques that we can use to ultimately get that property out of the person's own name and into a proper structure? So this is an example of a client that purchased a very significant home in California. The purchase price is approximately $50 million, and she actually took title directly as opposed to through an entity structure. One of the problems with once you acquire property directly, as I suggested, is that there's FIRPTA tax to the extent that you actually transfer the property out of your own name. So again, we would have a 15% tax on the amount realized. There's a strategy in which we can actually put debt against the property to reduce the value. So in this instance, the client was able to defray the tax by doing a couple of things. First of all, transferring the property from her own name into a US LLC. Second of all, requesting with a withholding certificate from the IRS to show that the amount realized on the transaction was effectively zero relative to her total gain. Because she did this right after she bought the property, her basis was $50 million. The quote unquote transfer to the US LLC should be disregarded for US purposes. So again, the transaction should not trigger any FIRPTA tax, and so therefore we request the withholding certificate. And then the last piece of it is actually to put debt against the property. So one of the planning techniques that we often use for foreign clients is to use what's called non-recourse debt, which means debt where the creditor can only go against the property, they can't look to the client. And most typical mortgages in the US are going to be non-recourse, meaning that the bank that's lending on the property is going to look purely to the property value and not to the ultimate owner of the home to the extent that the debt needs to be paid and there's a default. So we put non-recourse debt against this property. And when you do that, you effectively only include in the client's estate the equity of redemption value, which is effectively the fair market value less the debt. Next slide, please. So I know I'm covering a lot of ground here, but I want to think about sort of appropriate levels of planning for both US persons as well as non-US persons. And I think you can kind of put it into three different categories. And I kind of use this this technique with clients in terms of describing it as, should you be buying estate planning, meaning should you be doing a lot of estate planning to minimize tax? Should you be selling estate planning, which means you have the ability to simplify because you don't have substantial tax considerations? Or should you be holding and kind of reevaluating as you move along? So for US persons, and again, this is US citizens and US domiciliaries, again, for US estate tax purposes, rule of domicile, are you physically present and do you intend to remain indefinitely? That typically also sweeps in US green card holders. If you're under $2 million of total net worth, then generally speaking, your best approach is to have a revocable living trust or wills to deal with the disposition of your property at death. If you're in the range of $5 to $10 million of total net worth, again, this is for US persons, generally speaking, you want to have some testamentary planning, some testamentary tax planning in your rev trust or wills, primarily to minimize the state estate tax considerations. So I mentioned New York has an exemption of about $6 million. Washington State, for example, has an exemption of only $2.2 million. So there's tax planning that we can put in the documents to think through and try to minimize state estate tax considerations. For those types of clients, we also recommend that annual exclusion gifting, so $16,000 per individual per year. And we might also do what are called some deathbed gifts to save state estate tax, depending upon which jurisdiction, which state the client is located in. And finally, for clients that are in that 10 to 20 and over 20 million, in both of those categories, so C and D, we're going to want to use those lifetime exemptions. So 12 million per individual, 24 million per couple. We're going to set up structures like spousal lifetime access trusts. We're going to gift assets to grandchildren or hypothetical future grandchildren. And we're going to do that through what's called a GST trust structure. We might have the clients consider putting their home into something called a qualified personal residence trust, which effectively gives you the ability to contribute your home to a trust, live in the home continuously for a period of years, and then have the home pass tax-free to your children or grandchildren in certain circumstances. And then ultimately, we'll also consider some charitable planning techniques. And charitable planning techniques can include setting up a private foundation, establishing a donor advised fund, or charitable remainder or charitable leave trust. If you are well in excess of $20 million of exemptions, there are other things that we would look to do, including making loans at the applicable federal rate, which is a special interest rate that the IRS publishes on a monthly basis. This is a rate that comes out and has been historically very low. It's creeping up as the Fed has now raised rates. The IRS has also pushed the AFR, but for a loan by way of example, in excess of 9 years. So any loan over 9 years to a family member made in the month of May, the rate would be about 2.6%. So much lower than what a child or grandchild could commercially borrow at. That's a really beneficial sort of transaction, a loan transaction, because if the child or grandchild takes the loan proceeds, reinvests at a higher rate of return than 2.6%, then in effect, what you have done is you've increased their net worth, you've frozen the value of what you gave them at the principal amount that you lent, plus that little 2.6% interest rate, and all of the appreciation that occurs in the assets in the hands of the children or grandchildren is ultimately outside of your estate. For non-US persons, so again, this is individuals and families that are not domiciled in the US, the exemptions, of course, are much lower. It's just $60,000 per individual. So in those instances, there's a substantial amount of planning that needs to be done, ideally before you establish or send children or grandchildren to the US to establish residency, or before you start acquiring, for investment purposes, assets in the US. The starting point is to look to see whether there's a treaty in place, and the U.S. has a number of tax treaties with other jurisdictions that address estate and gift tax. And as I listed here, those include Canada, the U.K., Germany, Australia, Japan, and France. You'll note that there is no estate tax treaty with China. So strategies for non-domiciled individuals and families would include, again, those annual exclusion gifts, those gifts directly to individuals for medical needs and education. And then gifting non-US situs assets. And this is probably the biggest planning technique that we have. So again, as I mentioned at the beginning, non-US persons are only subjected to the US estate tax on their US situs assets. U.S. CITUS assets for gift tax purposes do not include, by way of example, shares in a U.S. corporation. So if you're a client that owns Amazon stock, if you die with that stock, ultimately you're going to be subjected to a 40% U.S. estate tax. If you give that stock away during your lifetime to your kids or grandkids or a trust for their benefit, ultimately you are going to save 40% of the value of that stock. So it's really important to be thinking about gifting non-U.S. CITUS assets. U.S. CITUS assets for estate tax purposes, as I mentioned, do include shares in U.S. companies. It would include real estate that's held directly. It would also include tangible personal property that's physically located in the U.S. That can include currency that's on deposit at a U.S. financial institution. It can include hard currency or commodities like gold that are situated in a vault in the U.S. And probably the most common issue is artwork that's physically located in the U.S. So a really simple planning technique is that if you have a substantial artwork collection and you're not domiciled in the U.S., you need to try to have that artwork collection moved outside of the U.S. before your death to avoid the U.S. estate tax on those assets. Again, probably the most powerful planning technique from a pre-immigration planning perspective is to fund a U.S. or foreign trust with non-U.S. CITUS assets. And again, if that's properly structured, then ultimately what happens is that the initial value is, of course, not going to be subjected to U.S. estate tax, but kids and grandkids and, you know, multiple generations of the same family can continue to benefit from that trust without having the trust assets being subjected to U.S. tax. Life insurance is also an important tool in the toolbox. To the extent that you're an individual that has U.S. assets but doesn't have the ability to restructure, picking up some life insurance to pay effectively the U.S. tax on those assets at death also makes a lot of sense. Catherine, I'll turn it back to you.
Thank you, Jay. 那今天既然是讲这个跨境资产规划的话，我就顺便提醒大家几个。法律上的问题、也是中国人或者说是、华人在美国容易频频踩雷的地方。一个是刚才 Jay 已经仔细讲过的 FERPTA， 就是外国账户税收遵从法，这个是指、外国人购买美国的房地产在他出售的时候需要交的这个 15% 的这个税，这个我就不重复了。然后我讲一下外国银行账户申报法，这个就是平时大家知道的这个 FBAR。这个、外国银行申报法的主要要求就是说、如果你是在美国的一个人，比如说你是在美国的居民、那你在美国必须把你在海外所有银行账户的里面财产的总数算一下，如果是超过$10,000的话呢，那你就需要在美国去进行这个外国银行账户的申报，这个不是您报税的一部分，这是另外一个申报，是在 FinCEN， 就是反金融犯罪的那个网站上，它有一个叫 FBAR 的一个表格，是这个另外的一个申报表格。那很多人就说我在中国有好多个不同的账户，对吧？那就要这些账户都加起来，不仅是储蓄账户、比如说证券账户，就是 brokerage account， 股票账户，这些都要加起来。然后呢，不仅是说你自己名字下面的，如果你有签字权，比如说不一定是你名下，但是你有这个账户的支配权、签字权的话，那么这在这个FBAR 下面也算，所以要把这些数字加起来，就是进行在美国的申报。另外就是有的人刚才听了这个，比如说 Jay 在税务上的讲解以后，他说哇，我作为一个美国公民或者是居民的话，我的这个赠与税和遗产税还挺高的，那我能不能就是退出美国，我就放弃这个绿卡了？那么这个也不、这个当然是可以，你可以放弃美国绿卡，但如果是过去15年中你8年甚至是8年以上持有美国绿卡的话，也就是长期的美国绿卡持有人的话呢，你在离开美国的话会有很大的一笔退出税。总的来说计算的方法就相当于说你这一辈子的税都让你交完，一下子交完了就是退出，你才可以这个离开美国，放弃这个美国的绿卡。当然有很多人他在听完以后觉得还是不要放弃好，因为这个不放弃的话，这个税收的减免的额度，就是遗产税和赠与税，我们说 exemption 就豁免的额度会比较大。纽约州的话是600万，对吧？然后 federal 就是联邦的话，刚才 Jay 说了就是1200万，确切来说是1200零 60万，所以的话这个额度会比较大，夫妻两个人加起来就是有2400万，所以每个人就说这个绿卡，这张绿卡或者说这个公民的身份对你来说是合适还是不合适，每个人都有自己的不同的计算方法。那么最后我来总结一下哈，大家今天听了这个讲座以后，如果有这个需要，就是我刚才说的四大类人吧，比如说你是资产数额比较高，或者是企业家，或者是说比较成功的专业人士，医生啊，律师啊，然后或者说是比较喜欢冒险的人士啊，甚至是你就是一个普通人，但是说你是想把自己的事情规划的井井有条的话呢，你就可以自己去制定一个行动的计划，通常是一个5步的计划。第一步就是您首先要想清楚这个财产规划的目标是什么，你想保护谁，除了保护您自己，比如说不受这个债主或者是政府的这个追责追偿以外，还想保护谁，您是不是想保护您的父母，确保他们年老了以后有一个保障，还是想保护您的孩子，比如说可能您很相信您的孩子，但是您没法来控制他的婚姻状况，他想娶谁，他想嫁给谁，对吧？也许您想保护孩子，保护的对象是您孩子的这个将来的配偶，对吧？这个每个人的情况不一样，对吧？还是说您想保护您自己，确保你身后以后就是配偶不会做出一些让你觉得非常失望的这些举动，对吧？就是你要想清楚你这个财产规划的目标是什么，你保护的对象是谁，你爱的人是谁，对吧？所以你想保护他，想做出怎么样的一个规划。而且这个不是说年纪大的事情，年纪大的人才需要做的一个事情。年纪很轻的时候，我记得我是就是30出头的时候就做完这一套规划了，因为我就说觉得有必要对资产进行保护，对不对？因为做不管做医生做律师责任都是很重大的，所以资产保护是很重要的一个事情。另外呢，我也是想对我的父母，远在中国的父母，他们老了以后有一个保障，所以这个和我自己的年纪大小没有关系。当然年纪大的话呢就更加紧迫了，对吧？第二步的话呢就是理清资产和债务，这个有点像你买房子的过程哈，你去申请一个银行贷款的时候，银行会问你就是您的资产是多少，您的负债是多少，有一个个人或者是家庭的资产负债表，左边是你所有的资产，右边是你所有的欠的债，对吧？所以 要理清自己的资产和债务，这样专业人士才可以帮助你。这个资产和债务是指全球范围内。然后接下来呢，就是找到可以信任的专业人士帮助你来确定这个目标，因为你自己想好的一个初步的规划的目标，这是个人的一个想法，但能不能达到这个目标，用怎样的方式方法。刚才我的同事介绍了很多这个眼花缭乱的避税方法，很多这种包括是叫我们叫 planning tool， 就是规划的方式。那么你用怎样的规划方式是可行的，是需要专业人士和你共同探讨然后确定可以达到的目标。接下来第四步就是准备法律文书，不管是说比如说最常见的就是遗嘱，或者您想规避我刚才说这个费时费力的这个遗嘱认证过程的话，你就做信托，对吧？信托的话刚才说的就是一个三方合同，grantor trustee 和 beneficiary 立托人受托人和这个受益人三方之间的一个合同，然后还有就是说你就是和信托相关的各方面的文件都要做好。最后一步就是转移和变更拥有权，比如说你信托有了，信托那像是一个篮子，它是空的，对吧？你光设一个信托也没用，你得把你的资产给装进这个信托，对吧？那么或者说这刚才说的很多步骤涉及到一些有策略性的生前赠与，或者是说移民前的这些赠与，那你就都是涉及到财产的转移的这个过程，就等于是把信托的这个篮子装满，或者是说把你想要转移的财产给转移掉的这个过程。所以这是就需要做一个转移变更拥有权的这样的步骤。通常来说这五步做完以后呢，大多数人他就会觉得他的这个财产保护，他的资产的规划呢就做得比较到位。就我跑上来就跟大家说的就是您生命除了一个横轴，就是从出生到死亡的这个横轴以外呢， 还有一个纵轴，纵轴就是您生命的这个满意度，对吧？您的满意度，在这个做完所有的这个财产规划以后呢，生命的满意度也会大大的提高。大家可能还记得这个桥水基金的设立创始人 Ray Dalio 在他的那本书里面说的，他就说他自己做这个规划，财产规划做完以后，他就说了一句话，他说 ：“Well, now I am free to die, but I'm also free to live。”就是我不管生死，我都觉得没有什么负担 ，right？ Are you free to die? Are you free to live? Are you free to love? 你能不能义无反顾的去爱一个人，对吧？去跟他结婚成家？所以这个财产规划的话，是可以使你生命满意度提高的一个事情。那时间关系，我们的讲座就做到这里为止。接下来可以问一下 Haley， 我知道 Haley 在统计这个观众和听众里面的这些问题，看大家也提了很多问题。Haley， 你看一下有没有可以根据有代表性的问题，看这边J 和我可以跟大家回答一下。
因为事件的关系，我知道还有下一个活动，您我不知道您那边有多长时间，
我们没问题，延长5到10分钟没关系。
One specific question that we got regarding stock, actually, with the example of the Amazon stock, the gifter avoids the 40% inheritance tax, and how about the recipient? Will your child or grandchild receiving the Amazon stock need to pay tax at the time they receive the gift or when they sell the Amazon stock?
Yeah, that's a great question. So again, for somebody who's not domiciled in the US, if they make a gift of Amazon stock during their lifetime to their child or grandchild, there's no imposition of US gift tax. So there's a savings of 40%. The recipient child or grandchild would not have to pay any sort of inheritance tax. So they take the Amazon shares, without paying any tax. If they turn around and sell the Amazon shares, assuming that they are US persons, that the recipient is a US person, there would be US capital gains tax. So if your Amazon stock was purchased at, $100 a share, and now it's sitting at, $3,200 a share, then you've got built-in capital gains tax that will be imposed on the recipient. Please note that the better planning technique, to the extent that there's going to be a substantial amount of stock gifted, and again, it's going to a recipient that from a recipient or from a grantor who's not a US person to a recipient that is a US person, the better approach is going to be to gift that stock into a US trust so that ultimately when the recipient passes away, there's no estate tax on the value of that stock.
Great. Thank you so much, Jay.
Sure.
And I guess switching gears a little bit back to the trusts. One person asked, how about children's custody issues if both parents passes away? Would a trust help with this? One more like basic question.
No, that's also a great question. So, one of the basic functions of a will or a rev trust, but typically it's going to be a will, is to name guardians for minor children. And the whole point of that is to tell the world effectively, who it is that you want to care for minor children in the event that both spouses pass away. And so the easiest way to do that is through the execution of a will.
Yeah, that's actually very important because, a lot of Chinese families, they assume that if something happens to them, like a traffic accident when both parents are in the same car, the grandparents, right? Especially if the grandparents live in the same household, most Chinese families assume that the grandparents will have the guardianship of the grandchildren, especially if they're in the same household. The law is different because, as Jay said, if you don't have an arrangement such as a will, then the state will step in, and then your child may be traumatized by having to live under a roof of a stranger's home. So yes, grandparents may eventually obtain the legal guardianship through court proceedings, But that takes time. It may take a year or two. So if you don't want to, you know, interrupt your children's life for so long, a will is a good arrangement.
Great question.
And I think we have time for one more question. Let me see. One person asked, if you have time, can you elaborate a bit on how to use insurance as part of estate planning?
Sure. So for a non-US person, the death benefit that's paid by an insurance policy is not going to be deemed to be a US situs asset. So let's just say that you pick up life insurance, it's got $1 million death benefit, and you own $1 million home directly. So there's going to be a 40% tax at death on the value of that home, and you need at least $400,000 in this example of coverage for the estate tax. The death benefit that's paid by the insurance policy, again, if you're not a U.S. person, would be swept out of your estate because it's deemed to be an intangible for estate tax purposes. If you're a U.S. person, then the typical approach is, again, we want to provide liquidity for death tax, so liquidity for estate tax purposes. So the general approach is to actually have what's called an irrevocable life insurance trust purchase the policy, ensuring the life of the parents. When that parent passes away, the death benefit is paid to the trust. Because it's paid to the trust, because the trust owned the policy, there's no U.S. estate tax on the value of the death benefit, and then the trust can ultimately use the liquidity to pay estate tax on other assets that the clients may have left to their children or grandchildren. If life insurance is owned directly by a U.S. person and they die owning that policy, the value of the life insurance proceeds will be included for U.S. estate tax purposes. So that's a very important distinction.
Great. Thank you so much, Jay. And also thank you so much, Catherine. I think it was a very informative webinar today. Before we officially end, also feel free to chime in, but both Catherine and Jay's contact information is on the current slide. So I believe that if attendees have any questions regarding this presentation, they can feel free to reach out. And before we officially end, I have two announcements. One for our members who are attending the event today, save the date for our annual member meeting on June 30th. A reminder is when you X out of this webinar, there'll be a survey that pops up featuring potential legal and policy topics that for future CGCC events. So please let us know which topics you'd be interested in learning about. We greatly appreciate your feedback. So I want to thank Catherine and Jay again for today's presentation, and we hope to see you at future CGCC events.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.